Jeremy Ferris, thank you for sticking around. We appreciate it. During the legislative session, there was a proposed constitutional amendment that would have directed the State Ethics Commission to get involved in determining salaries for state officials, which would include legislators. Is that something that you see as potentially being in the purview of the Ethics Commission?
Senate Joint Resolution 7, that was an interesting bill that would have created that constitutional amendment. It's not an entirely novel idea. Other states have put the salary setting function with independent commissions. Arkansas, California, Washington are all examples. That particular bill made it through the Senate Rules Committee, and it made it through the Senate Judiciary Committee as amended. The initial bill would have given the salary setting function to include county elected officials as well.
Okay.
There's about 315 state elected officials. There's roughly that many county elected officials around the state. The first bill that made it through Senate Rules was for all of that, but it was kind of truncated and just for state elected officials to include legislators, the executive officials, and the judiciary.
Okay.
The elected judges.
And that's, just to interject, the elected judges all the way down to like magistrate court judges?
That's correct.
Okay.
From the Supreme Court through the Court of Appeals, through district court judges, through magistrate court
okay.
judges.
Okay.
Probate judges are county judges. The commission decided to remain neutral in its meeting. It discussed the issue and isn't taking a position one way or another on that bill. And I anticipate that would be the commission's reaction in the future if the bill was reintroduced. There are arguments on both sides. I mean, a citizens' legislature has been with the state since its founding in 1912. There are countervailing arguments for paying legislators a salary that's beyond the per diem and mileage that they currently receive. I mean, one particularly strong argument in my own personal view is that it might enable folks that don't have the resources to run for state office to serve as a legislator because they're not independently wealthy or they don't have the kind of the resources to just serve as a legislator, which is nearly a full-time job, particularly in the years where there's a 60-day session when you think of all the interim committee meetings they have. Serving in the legislature is more than just volunteer work. It's very nearly a full-time job, and so that prevents a large segment of New Mexicans from serving in that capacity. So, I mean, there are arguments for increasing legislative pay. There are also arguments for increasing judicial pay. According to the National Conference of State Courts, New Mexico is 45th in 2020 for how district court judges are paid. It's 48th for how Supreme Court justices are paid as compared to other states. And you might think that that result is in itself an argument for giving the salary function to somewhere else. But one kind of not result dependent, but result independent procedural argument for having a commission, an independent commission, do the salary setting function is that any commission that's set up to do that, be that the Ethics Commission or yet another independent commission, the salary setting function in a commission would have to be done under the State Rules Act and the State Rules Rule. It would have a salary table or whatever the salary rule would be would have to come out of a public rule hearing. And that's a very reason-forcing process. There would have to be an initial issuance of what the salary table or the salary rule would be. The public would have an opportunity to file written comment on the rules or the salary table, to appear at a public rule hearing and speak to their concerns. Under the State Rules Act and the State Rules Rule, if the public files a written comment, the agency has to respond in writing to what that comment was when it issues the final rule. So vesting this function, the salary setting function, in a state agency or in an independent commission means it would have to go through the State Rules Act and the State's rule, which means the process would be very participatory and very reason forcing. And that is probably an independent argument for maybe vesting the salary setting function elsewhere. The Ethics Commission is an independent commission. It's in the Constitution and the State Ethics Commission statute, the way that the commissioners are appointed, as I discussed earlier, ensures the independence of that commission from political forces about as well as you can do.
Okay.
Senator Tallman in the Rules Committee mentioned, well, we don't need yet another commission to do this function. So that was kind of his support for the Ethics Commission having the function. But whoever it would be, it would have, as I said, have to go through the State Rules Act, and it would be a transparent, participatory, and reason-giving process.
One of the things that interests me about the idea of paying legislators a salary is you look at elected officials like the PRC. In another life, I recall doing a story on a PRC commissioner who had a subcontract with somebody who was working on roads, and middle of the week, he's out down by Truth or Consequences doing some road work. When we talked on air, you talked about abandonment of duties. Would there be a reason or precedent to allow legislators to earn a salary but also to have another job? Or would there be a prohibition against that?
Very likely. If a constitutional amendment like Senate Joint Resolution 7 passed the legislature and passed the people by a vote, the provisions of the Constitution that would speak to constraining what other salaries or what other compensation legislators might receive would be the Emoluments Clause of the New Mexico Constitution and the Extra Compensation Clause. There is law that kind of puts a sphere around whatever other compensation legislators might receive. And I think by receiving a salary, that this is part of the attempt to professionalize the legislature, as it were, to ensure that this is the single job that legislators would do and receive a salary from the state for it. And they couldn't receive extra compensation or emoluments for the same work that they do for which the state pays them. Now, that doesn't mean that they couldn't, you know, do other jobs. The abandonment of duties statute, you know, does contemplate for other unrelated jobs. But the serving as a legislature, I think, is so all-consuming that really what we're talking about is a salary and then a prohibition on other compensation for work that touches the legislative work by the Emoluments Clause and the Extra Compensation Clause.
I can think of a number of legislators who I won't name, but who would probably say, well, wait a second, you can't make me quit my job to keep being a legislator. I like being an attorney, or I like being a teacher, or something like that. Would it have that impact that you would have to be a professional legislator and essentially anything else would be part-time?
It might. It very well might have that consequence. It's not only salaries, I think, that the legislator in particular legislators are thinking about when professionalizing the legislature. They're thinking about additional duties, additional staff. I mean, I think this is an idea and part of a swirl of ideas to make the job a bit more intensive. And I think if that were the result, then the legislators, they might not any longer have the time to also serve as a full-time teacher or full-time attorney. I think that's part of the idea of what it would mean to have a professional legislature as representatives for whom representing their constituents is their job.
Okay. Jeremy Ferris, thanks again for your extra time. We appreciate it.
Thank you.